So thank you all for joining us for this presentation tonight. We're doing a low-lying roads for the town of Chatham. I'm Tara Lewis, Water Resources Analyst at the Cape Cod Commission, and I'm joined by a couple other Cape Cod Commission staff, as well as Joe Famley from the Woods Hole Group. And this is our second round for this project. It's funded under MVP Action Grant. The first round included exactly 10 Cape towns, and we're really wrapping that up at this point. And so this is our second round for the remaining 5 towns on Cape Cod, including Chatham. So our purpose tonight, there we go. Purpose tonight is to review the flood projections and impacts on the town roadways under future scenarios. We'll discuss the vulnerable low-lying roads and other transportation infrastructure that we've identified through the analyses we've done, with the hope that this will prepare the town to address some road segments for design and permitting. Takes a little while. Sorry, a little delay there. And I went too far, didn't I? Yeah, I'm having that same issue where. The button to advance goes away and can't find it right away. So anyway, our agenda tonight includes a project overview, kind of a big picture of the grant and our timeline. And then I'll turn it over to Joe, who will review the vulnerability and risk assessment and present the results of our low-lying road prioritization and discuss how it was done. We'll take some clarifying questions as we go along if needed, and then we'll have a discussion, finally wrapping things up with next steps, hopefully concluding in about an hour and a half. So as I indicated earlier, this work is funded by the MVP program. We are referring to it as Low-Lying Road 2 project because it follows the work we did with the other 10 Cape Cod town communities under the Low-Lying Road 1 project. So for the future Low-Lying Road 2 project, we're working with Chatham, Harwich, Falmouth, Mashpee, and Provincetown. Through this work, we have been and will continue to examine the vulnerability of roads to coastal flooding. The work identifies priority road segments, and hopefully the analysis will help towns select priority roads for future work. And then a later phase of the project will develop design solutions for each of the different road segments in town. So we know already that we're experiencing flooding from coastal storms, and in some communities, sunny day flooding from sea level rise. So this work we're doing under this project will better will help us better understand the future threats we may observe from the combined effects of sea level rise and coastal storms. This project focuses on just coastal storms and not on inland flooding that is a result of heavy rain events. Part of our goal is to identify a variety of potential solutions for roads. These may include gray infrastructure, green infrastructure, or hybrid solutions. I'm sure many of you are already aware of the various green or traditional engineering infrastructure approaches that may be applied. Part of our focus here is to try to identify green or nature-based solutions to enhance habitat improvements, as well as improve resiliency of roads. A third approach includes hybrid solutions that utilize both gray and green infrastructure. And then in some cases, abandonment might be the best alternative. So our timeline began with an MVP grant awarded last fall in 2022. Earlier this spring, the vulnerability assessment under 3 future time horizons was done, looking at 2030, 2050, and 2070. And Joe will get into more detail on how we identified the flood projections for those time horizons. In April, the criticality framework was applied to assess which roads are most important for protection in order to help us prioritize those roads. Tonight, we're presenting the results of those analyses. So we're at the May 2023 point on this timeline. And then this summer, we'll be conducting site visits for some of the vulnerability roads. And then next spring, we'll return with design alternatives that we've identified for two road segments in a second workshop. So I'm going to pause here to see if there are any clarifying questions about the overall project. Feel free to raise your hand if you have any questions. I believe that the raise hand button is down the bottom of your screen. And I'll just give you a couple beats to find that. If anyone has any questions, they can raise a hand, or actually feel free to unmute yourself and just ask. We don't have a large crowd. Okay, well, seeing none, I will turn the presentation over to Joe.
Thanks, Tara. Okay, welcome everybody. Thanks for joining us tonight. as Tara indicated, the Cape Cod Low-Lying Roads project is focused on two climate-related hazards that affect us here on the Cape, both separately and in tandem, and they are coastal in nature, so sea level rise and coastal storm surge in future climate scenarios with sea level rise. So here in Massachusetts, we benefit from a lot of great climate change planning and programmatic work on the state level. So the Executive Office of Energy and Environmental Affairs, who sponsor the Municipal Vulnerability Preparedness Program that we're doing this work under, has developed a number of climate projections for various climate-related hazards, including sea level rise and storm surge, as well as precipitation and heat. So I'm going to do a little bit of an overview of the sea level rise and storm surge projections that we use in this assessment, so you have a baseline of understanding. So the sea level rise projections that we're working with are shown on this graph for the Cape region, specifically the south side of the Cape. They have been developed based on downscale global climate models for local and applied to local tide gauges throughout the Commonwealth. The ones that we leverage in this region are Woods Hole and Nantucket. And the state took a probabilistic approach to developing those sea level rise projections. And what that means is they looked at the confidence in terms of under-predicting, whether or not they've under-predicted or over-predicted sea level rise in a range of greenhouse gas emission scenarios, and considering factoring in the best available science in terms of contributions from ice sheet melt. The scenario that was selected by the state for climate change planning and in projects like these is the high scenario. It is the blue line that you see on this chart, which indicates up to 1.4 feet of sea level rise compared to a 2008 baseline as soon as 2030, up to 2.7 feet by as soon as 2050. And up to 4.5 feet as soon as 2070. But as you'll see in the blue box that talks about the various confidence intervals, these are very conservative projections. Considering greenhouse gas emissions alone under a range of either high or initial increase and then over the long-term decrease in emissions, we are highly confident. You see those 99.5 or greater confidence intervals that we are not under predicting sea level rise. Those drop a little bit when you start to factor in ice sheet melt, but they are still pretty high. And that's, you know, the right thing to do for planning purposes. You don't want to get it wrong in the wrong direction. But there is a chance that these are potentially overpredicting some of that that sea level rise. I'm showing on this graph the range of scenarios that were considered. So it's not the extreme, but we also look to that green line on the bottom, which is an intermediate scenario. Slightly lower confidence intervals in terms of overpredicting, underpredicting. But as you get down to considering ice sheet melt, you're almost at a coin toss. So we are a little less comfortable adopting those as the standard. What you can do, however, is use these projections flexibly. So if that 1.4 as soon as 2030 doesn't come to pass, that might be, if you track to the right across your screen, very similar to a 2050 projection under the intermediate scenario. 1.4, 1.6 are pretty close together. Same thing, 2.7 on the high scenario for 2050. Track that across to the green line, 2.6. This could be your 2070. So all is that to say, there's a wide range of projections out there, and you know, climate change is an uncertain science. And so our goal here is to apply those projections and our planning and our adaptations in a flexible manner so that we don't over-design, but we're prepared to respond to conditions as they change. That's sea level rise. The other climate-related hazard that we have exposure to are storms, coastal storms, both tropical hurricanes and extratropical storms, which are, you know, nor'easters. On the south side of the Cape, more exposed to hurricanes, which kind of track through very quickly, but, you know, also are susceptible to nor'easters, which tend to move more slowly. Maybe pass through on multiple tidal cycles or even days, which allows water levels to pile up. And we'll get into that a little bit more when we talk about the modeling. So we have a large data set of both historic and projected future coastal storms. And as we you know from reading the literature, there's an expectation that those storms will increase in frequency and intensity, especially hurricanes, as coastal waters and ocean waters warm and the climate changes over time. All of those things go into the flood risk model that we use in Massachusetts for climate change planning, which is the Massachusetts Coast Flood Risk Model. It's a hydrodynamic probabilistic model, and what you see on the map on the right here is going to show you the difference between a standard, what we call a bathtub model, which is just looking at a water surface elevation and projecting that across the landscape based on just elevation and topography, versus running it through a hydrodynamic model that accounts for all the physical processes that influence where water could go. So this is a storm surge event of about 12 feet NAVD 88 in elevation, just symbolized across the Boston Harbor region and beyond. And here is that same storm simulated through a hydrodynamic process. Happens to be a nor'easter, so you have winds and waves coming out of the northeast and pushing water up onto the south shore. You see those red higher water levels on the south shore and drawing it away from other areas. So that's the reason why we do this in a probabilistic manner, so that we have a better understanding of where water is. And the reason why we take this probabilistic approach is to help communities plan and prioritize and using a risk-based approach, and we'll get into that in a little bit later. So as I said, the Massachusetts Coast Flood Risk Model takes into account the sea level rise projections that we looked at, more frequent, more intense storms, both tropical and extratropical. We account for factors in the landscape that could influence how water flows across it, and flooding perpetuates across the landscape. For instance, a paved surface might allow water to move more rapidly across it rather than, as compared to an unpaved surface, a marsh, for example. Elevation is in the model, so we know how high the water levels could get across the landscape. And you know, all those factors in terms of climate change and intensification of storms are in there. It includes all of those physical processes that affect where water could go during a storm. So as we talked about earlier, tides, what are they doing? Is a storm coming on a high tide or a low tide? Is it a nor'easter that's sitting on us for multiple tidal cycles? That's all into this, put into this probabilistic assessment. So we run all of these different scenarios. Winds, waves, in areas where there's more development, we look at run-up and overtopping from wave action. And the primary output that we have is flood probability, or you'll see annual exceedance probability. And what that is just the annual chance of flooding at any particular place across the landscape during a single calendar year in that planning horizon. Some of the other data products that we have are flood depth. So we, you know, look at the comparison between the projected water surface elevation across a range of probability levels, compare that to the land elevation. You can get an idea of depth. We can also back out information on how long flooding might persist in a particular location. Volumes, we can look at pathways, how flooding can get to certain areas, and then develop some parameters from wind, waves, and currents that can inform design. It is a highly resolved model. So this is a visualization of the model mesh across Chatham. And at each of those intersections in this triangular framework, there's calculations being made for all those coastal storm surge events across the range of probabilities. In more developed areas, that scale of resolution gets down to on the order of 3 to 5 meters between nodes or points. So what you'll see in the next series of slides is the primary output of that flood risk model. It's the annual exceedance probability. Again, it's the annual chance of flooding during a calendar year. And in this case, we have three planning horizons. So the 2030, 2050, and 2070. Just to note on the legend, we have a wide range of probabilities, all the way from a 0.1%, which is the pink on the very left-hand side of the legend. 0.1% is a 1,000-year recurrence interval. It's a very high intensity, but low probability event. Point of reference, the light green is a 1% annual chance, annual exceedance probability. Slightly different parameters going into our calculation compared to FEMA, but the statistic of 1% is similar. 1% annual chance is the 100-year recurrence interval. You'll hear many people say the 100-year storm. It's not something that's going to happen only once every 100 years. It's a statistical probability, 1% annual chance. And then as you go further to the right of that legend, you get all the way up to the 100% annual exceedance probability, which would be the most common, probably low magnitude, but still potentially impactful annual storm. So your most common storm event, not indicative of tidal flooding and daily conditions though. So as we step through these maps, you'll see a couple of things. One, you'll see the extent of flooding change as it extends further into the landscape on higher water levels. And you'll see if you look at a particular point, probability of flooding going up. So the reds might turn to greens, the greens might turn to purples, and the purples might turn to blues. So under 2030 conditions, we have these patterns here. And as we jump to 2050, a little bit of extension in the floodplain. And then 2070, in some cases we see it intersect an elevation grade that can't penetrate much more. But in this case, we're seeing a couple areas where flooding extends, certainly, especially on the South Shore in Chatham, the probabilities are getting higher as we're exposed to more intense hurricanes in the future. I just want to give a little bit more background on those annual exceedance probabilities. As I said, they're annual chance of flooding. And just to kind of bring it down to a way we can all think about this in familiar terms, a 10% annual chance is it's a 1 in 10 chance. It would be like rolling a 10-sided die. And, during the calendar year, you hit a 5, you're flooded, right? The 1% chance, 1 in 100 annual chance. So that would be like rolling a 100-sided die and coming up with whatever number you think you might pick. That 0.1%, the 1,000-year recurrence interval, is, as I said, very high intensity but low probability. That would be the equivalent of roughly the equivalent of rolling 2 30-sided dice and hitting the same number on both of them at the same time. But what we have to consider is how those probabilities accumulate over time. Bob, I see a question. We're almost at a place where I'm going to pause and ask
you're,
for...
You're answering it, so I'm going okay. to follow me.
Great. There's a lot of numbers on these tables, but when we think about the lifespan of infrastructure that we're planning for the future, we have to think about how those annual exceedance probabilities play out over the usable life of that infrastructure, right? So you might think, a 1% annual chance storm, 1 in 100 years, we can build a road, we'll be fine. But if you have, whatever the lifespan of that infrastructure is, 10, 25, 50 years or more, the chance of that annual exceedance probability occurring at least once during the lifespan, during whatever these cumulative amounts of years are, increases. So for instance, a 0.1% annual exceedance probability event, the 1,000-year recurrence interval, has a 1% chance of happening over a 10-year period, 2.5% chance over a 25-year period, and roughly 5% over a 50-year period. You might be able to live with that. And that's a question of risk tolerance, right? If you have a piece of infrastructure that just can't fail, it's, whatever, life-saving, for instance, hospitals might have a very low risk tolerance for their generators. They just can't allow flooding to take that offline because it's a life and safety issue. They might design to that level. A 1% annual chance event has almost a 10% chance of occurring over a 10-year period, 22% chance over a 25-year period. Think about the lifespan of a mortgage, roughly 30 years. And over a 50-year period, which many roads are designed for, you might have up to a 40% chance of that flood level occurring over that design life. And then once you talk about a 10% annual chance event, you're getting past 10 years, you're almost nearly certain to have that type of event happen over 25 or more years. So with that said, I'll pause for any clarifying questions on the modeling or probabilities before we move on to the methods and results of the assessment. Yes, Adrian.
Hi, I'm curious why there doesn't seem to be any consideration of change in rainfall going forward with a model with this kind of range.
Yeah, that's a good question. There are those projections are available. They just weren't built into the Massachusetts Coast Flood Risk Model. We have done a couple projects where we've integrated stormwater. So in some of the larger river systems, we do have, you know, the contribution from the watershed rainfall going down the river and potentially flooding. I don't think there are any examples of that on the Cape. We just don't have big rivers here. But there's an added level of modeling complexity when you try to factor in stormwater. That said, a lot of what we're finding is, you know, when we do model stormwater, it is swamped out by the coastal signal. So if you have an event where there's both happening at the same time, the coastal surge is much larger in quantity and volume than the precipitation. Now, if you have a high tide event in the future, maybe that's backing up a coastal outfall and you have a connected drainage system above it, then you might see some additional flooding that you might not normally see, especially if you have larger rainfall events, which, you know, we have been seeing on the Cape in recent years. But it's a good point. That is another factor to consider. It's just not in this particular model. It is when you get to design, there is guidance available at the state level in terms of what design storms you should be considering from a precipitation standpoint. So we could look at the design parameters in terms of elevation targets for coastal surge. And then, you know, as you're designing the drainage to go along with that, there are projected design storms for future climate conditions available for precipitation as well. So really good question. I hope I answered it for you.
Thank you. Yes, timing of precipitation and this boom and bust drought kind of thing we've been having lately is concerning. Thank you.
Any other clarifying questions? So we'll briefly go over how we apply those flood risk model projections to the road network to assess the vulnerability of the road system, and then how we extrapolate that to risk. So first, as I mentioned, we have the range of coastal flood exceedance probabilities, annual exceedance probabilities, from 0.1% to 100. There are different water levels associated with all of those different statistics. And what we've done across the Cape is to break up the road network into very small refined points at a small interval and extract the land elevation, the elevation of the road from the latest available topographic information. And you see that, you know, that ends up being a whole series of dots across the landscape. Here's a small snippet that you'll see in the next set of slides, a road next to a coastal wetland. And we compare the land elevation. So at the top, you see that segment of road in profile. There's like a dip in the road. And we can also see it in cross section here on the black line at the bottom. So as I said, there are water levels and you can see all those different rainbow colors going across either the profile or the cross section, water levels associated with all those probability levels. And we compare that to the land elevation, which you can see in gray on both of those sections. And as you would expect, as you step through time in these projections for 2030 and 2050 and 2070, the extent of flooding is going to increase because you have higher water levels. So you'll see the water levels go up on the cross section on the bottom, and then the water levels will go up and the extent of flooding will go out towards the sides of that profile as the extent increases. So that's how we did the vulnerability assessment for this project. We just took the elevation of all the road segments throughout the town and compared those to the projected water surface elevations. That gave us the assessment of vulnerability, but we wanted to take it an extra step so that you know, towns and you all as residents can start to prioritize, because you know, there are differences in the road network in terms of their use and services. So we developed in collaboration with the Cape Cod Commission this criticality scoring framework from available regional data. And that assessed the usage and network function of the road. So we looked at traffic counts and sort of the classification of whether or not the road was anywhere from a local road up to a interstate highway, which, you know, we don't have on the Cape, but, you know, as you go into the higher classifications of roads, they, you know, serve more of a transportation purpose. We looked at whether or not each road segment intersected a area where our businesses were. We looked at whether or not the road intersected a vulnerable population. And we also looked at whether or not the road was an access or primary or secondary access for a range of community and emergency services. And that all rolled into a score that we applied to the road network. And then combined with the flooding, the flood probability gave us an assessment of risk. So you see the steps here. We've already talked about 1 through 4. So compare the elevations to the water levels to get the flood probability, score the criticality, and multiply those two things together to get risk. So the idea is a high probability of flooding on a high criticality road, a very important road, will yield a high risk result. And theoretically, those are the ones that we want to focus on for adaptation. And when you have risk scores over time, you have you can develop a plan to, you know, look at higher risk roads in an earlier time frame, and then plan to look at some of the higher risk ones that come up over time in the future as climate change evolves. So before we move on to the results, the other thing to say is that through this process, once we've identified those high risk roads, the town will select, in this case, two of their top priorities, and we'll begin to look at those for adaptation and develop some conceptual level designs and cost estimates. So I'll go through the results we looked at high tide flooding, we mapped out mean high water based on those sea level rise projections. So the average of all of the high tides in the day. In Chatham, you know, we saw pretty limited potential exposure to high tide flooding under 2030 conditions, less, you know, 0.2 of a mile under 2050 conditions, it was 2.4, and even on a high emissions, high sea level rise scenario in the far future, you're still under 6 miles of roadway, which is very little. So, but still something to consider. There are some roadways that may in the future, be inaccessible on average a daily basis. And then here's an example of the vulnerability assessment. So comparing those coastal storm probabilities to the road surface elevations. And you'll see on the right, there's a bar chart and a table that gives you the total mileage of roadway affected by all those different probability levels. And the mileage increases over time, right? And it increases as you go into a more intense, lower probability storms. So under 2030 conditions, we have 7 miles of roadway affected by a 10% annual exceedance probability, almost 11 affected by a 1% annual exceedance probability storm, and up to 14 miles of road under the most extreme storm in 2030 conditions. 2050 conditions, obviously there's bigger storms, higher water levels, so that 10% annual exceedance probability affects over 11 miles of roadway, the 1% affects over 16 miles, and the 0.1% affects almost 20 miles. And, long-term sea level rise, long-term high rates of sea level rise could produce with coastal storms, 13 miles of roadway under a 10% probability level, a little over 18 miles of roadway on that 1% annual chance event, and over 22 miles in the most extreme 0.1%. Here's an example of the results of the criticality assessment. Generally, what we see is that based on that scoring framework, the higher criticality areas are associated with the major traffic corridors, and sometimes those tend to be the state roads, and also the areas where there's more dense development, business, community services, et cetera. So in Chatham, those scores ranged from about 5 to 70 on an overall, 0 to 100 scale. And that was factored into the vulnerability assessment to develop these next set of maps, which look at risk. So the way to read these are like a heat map, low risk being green, high risk being the warmer oranges and reds. And we developed a list of high priority road segments for the town and you all to consider and select from, or potentially suggest others, as the case may be, for adaptation planning. So under 2030 conditions, just two examples. In Chatham, we had segment A, which is a segment of Bridge Street. It's the western approach to the Mitchell River Bridge. The eastern side is a little bit higher. Segment B is Champlain Road, which is west of the Port Fortunes Lane area. And we can look at this, all of these segments, in a little more detail when we get to the data viewer. Under 2030 conditions, we had a couple other roads that came to priority. These are two segments of Stage Harbor Road. Segment F is at Pond Street, which is behind Oyster Pond Beach. And segment G is at the intersection with Champlain Road, which is right where the Harbor Master's office is, and a creek crossing. under 2070.
You had condition. Those two reversed.
I did.
Yeah.
F is
at Champlain Road and G is at Pond Street.
You're right. Yep. Sorry, that was a mislabeled. Yeah,
legend's not quite right.
Yep. The legend is the table is what you'll see in the data viewer. These callouts are just swapped in terms of the lettering. Thanks for pointing that out. 2070, a couple others to highlight were two segments of Route 28, Orleans Road. The western one is segment E, which is at the top of Ryder Cove near the Herring Brook crossing. And segment K is to the east at the Frostfish Creek crossing. So there are others that we can look at as we dig deeper into the results. Just gave some examples for you all to kind of consider how this plays out. So here's the full results. Based on that risk assessment over time and the segments that were rising to the top, we made a list of all those road segments. There's a length associated with them that kind of ties into higher ground. There's a description, obviously, to kind of key you into where they are in town. The annual exceedance probability for a 2030 climate condition, that's the annual chance of flooding. The criticality score and the risk score for 2030, as you can see that calculation made. And then an indication of the potential length of road segment that could be exposed to high tide flooding. Bob, you have a question.
Yeah, to what extent did you take into account and I'm thinking specifically for the Mitchell River Bridge. It floods on the west side, but I can still get to it. I can still get to the bridge from the east side. I mean, did you take that into account versus a road that it's basically one way in, one way out? So if that road floods, it's really problematic as opposed to a road where, I can't get there. I just go around the other direction.
A different way. Yeah, that did it. It didn't directly go into any of the scoring, but as we were reviewing the results, we did prioritize the bridge and the approach to the bridge as it seemed like a main thoroughfare, and the western approach was low, but we did identify some segments that are sort of one way in, one way out to certain areas.
Okay, thank you,
Joe. This is Ted. I had a very similar question, and I was thinking more the Champlain Road as an example.
Okay.
I mean, we're familiar with that low section. But, you have it rated as obviously a high risk area. And I'm just trying to understand why, because, again, you can get there from a different direction. There are no real critical facilities that I'm thinking. And it just.
This was segment G, Ted?
Yes.
Or B.
Oh, wait. Oh, now I'm confused. It was one of the ones that you showed early on, I think, in your sample.
Yeah, I think he's talking about segment B.
Yeah, we can look at that when we get into the data viewer. It is it's just a low spot on the road.
Yeah.
And I think the thing that I'd mention here is there were all those factors that we reviewed that went into the criticality assessment.
Right.
Those are based on regionally available data, and we certainly defer to you and folks in town in terms of there may be other factors that play into this.
I get that. I mean, and again, just repeating Bob's point, the one way in to me, from a emergency response perspective. Is critical. One of the pictures you showed was, the Morris Island kind of access flooded out. And once that floods, the whole Morris Island is, you know, high and dry, but right. You can't get there.
Right.
So Champlain Road, just again, just to pick that one apart, you go around the other way and so what? There's only a couple homes that are sort of modestly impacted. So it just, again, I think we need to delve into sort of how you assigned risk for some of these, because they just didn't seem, from my gut feeling, you know, perhaps, you know, the ones we choose, so to speak.
Yeah, and that's fine. You know, we went through the process of assessing the probability of flooding. And then that criticality score, I said, is, as I said, it's, you know, based on regionally available data, and there's certainly local factors to consider that just can't go into a process that's, you know, designed to be applied, you know, across the whole region. So we definitely look to you to say, yeah, you know, segment B is not that important to us. It scored high on criticality. It's certainly low. It must have scored high on criticality for some reason, but maybe that's not the one that carries the day in terms of selecting what your priorities are.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
When you put this table together, is it possible to put them in ranking order by the criticality score, as opposed to now where it kind of bounces all over the place?
Starting with the
highest criticality score and then go to the lowest, basically.
Yeah, we can do that. We can send you a table. It's going to be a long table.
Yeah. Okay.
But you know, the other thing maybe to do is when you get to exploring the data viewer, you can look at the criticality scores, and this would be a good thing to show after Tara reviews a couple other things. You can look at the criticality score, key in on an area that is scoring high on criticality, and then turn on the flood probability or the risk and see how that, you know, see how that looks. Be easier, I think, than sorting through a long table of results.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So Tara, do you want to go into discussion? We've had a little discussion already, but
yeah. Sure. Yeah, let's bring up the next slide is queuing us up for discussion, which we've already started. So that's good. At this point, we would like to hear your reactions to what you've seen. Our purpose of this meeting is to get feedback from the community. Joe's given us a lot of detailed information and the review of the model and the process for IDing low-lying roads. It's a lot of information, it's a lot to think about, but the different roads become vulnerable at different future points in time and have varying levels of importance based on our analyses. And as Joe mentioned, the criticality scoring is based on regional data. So we'd like to hear from your perspective what roads are important, you know, with the local knowledge that you have, because ultimately for the second phase of this project, town staff will identify two road segments that we'll look into in more detail to design some adaptation solutions and, you know, the using the MCFRM, which is the sophisticated model in that regional data set that I provided, that I mentioned, that Joe mentioned also, is, you know, it provides us with this summary table of roads, but they may not necessarily be in alignment with the roads the community is aware of. And so we want to provide an opportunity to identify other roads that might be a priority based on your own movements through town during storm events. At this time, I will advance to the next slide, which poses a few questions, but clearly we're already in this discussion mode. So I invite you to raise your hand and make some suggestions and ask some questions, and you know, we'll begin this group discussion. Go ahead, Bob W.
Yeah, it's Bob Wirtschafter. Yeah, I guess I was wondering if we had the ability to look at the critical scores and maybe do our own values. If are you trying to do that tonight? That's one question. But my bigger question, it seems to me, is when you pinpoint down on a little bit of the road that has a highest probability, that may not actually be the worst case. The worst case is if a bigger portion of road flooded out or under one of the higher lower probability cases. But when we're addressing fixing these, are we addressing just that little bit that comes up as the high probability, or are we looking to fix a whole, half mile of road that is within any of those probabilities?
Yeah, it depends on the segment, to be honest, Bob. Some of them are very small, in which case they kind of tie into some high ground relatively quickly, and others are longer. There's certainly we can explore different lengths under different probability levels through what we've seen going through this with other towns. The tie-in points to a low spot up to a that's maybe experiencing 120% level flooding, tying into like a 5 or a 1% point, an elevation that's only exposed to that lower level of exceedance probability is usually feasible. If you have a long, low segment without, a real good tie-in, then you're talking about a really, really big project. Generally, that's going to be in a wetland area, which is going to have regulatory impacts as well, in terms of designing and permitting the project. I don't recall seeing many of those in Chatham. I guess
Morris Island Road's
the Morris Island is just child for that one. That could be a problem. Yeah.
Poster child, yeah.
So how does the cost of ultimately how much each of these is going to cost should affect our priority, not just the risk of the damage, but also the cost of fixing them. So is there a way to factor that in? I mean, some of these, as you said, are little small segments. They probably could be done fairly easily. I'm not even sure we need your help to identify what to do on those, and yet there's others here where we probably need some big engineering work to solve. So I guess has that become any part of the conversation, or is that a later thing?
Well, it's part of it. It depends on what we end up or you end up designing to or stating as a target. Sometimes we're looking for tie-in points, and sometimes that informs the design and therefore the level that you can achieve will inform the cost. The approach can inform the cost. So if we do like a traditional road raising that has a certain set of parameters where you need to think about fill and side slopes. If you're in a wetland area and you're concerned about impacts to that wetland area based on that elevation, you don't want the side slopes. You have to think about sheet piling. That has a cost. If we're looking at green solutions, we might have a culvert upsizing to facilitate a wetlands migration and restoration behind it, or we might have a dune or coastal bank restoration, and that has different costs. So it really depends on the individual situation of the roadway. As we go into these conceptual level designs. And as you know, some of these are going to require a traditional, transportation engineering firm to carry forward. At this stage of conceptual level, we're going to, come up with some ideas, test them out, whether or not you can achieve certain goals, and then develop some planning level cost estimates. So we're working with a construction consulting engineer that has been helping us cost out some of these things. So you get like sort of a not full design and permitting and implementation costs, but some like installed material costs to use as a comparative measure.
Adrian, do you have a question?
I do. I have a question and a comment, I suppose. So looking back at the scoring framework, it seems by the graphic design, I suppose, of the slide that the four categories of community / emergency services, vulnerable populations, usage, network function, and economy, it kind of looks like they're weighted equally, but what is actually the math on those weights, and is this available published anywhere?
Yeah, they were, all those categories were weighted equally. And you can, when we look at the map viewer, you can turn on both the criticality layer to see the overall score and all of the individual scores that went into it. And we also have published all of the data sets that informed that criticality score.
Great. Are those, along with the published data sets, are these layers going to be available anywhere that is not a map viewer, but downloadable? I could put it in ArcPro and look at it,
Oh, we haven't gotten that question before.
That's a new one. I do think that a lot of our GIS layers are available for downloading at
it's not on the Open Data Hub. Yeah, I've been keeping an eye on that.
Okay. Well, I'll maybe one of my other commission staff know the answer to that, if it will be on the GitHub.
Heather McElroy, I don't know the answer to that question, and that's an interesting question. We can take that back and explore whether that's possible to share at the regional scale.
Great. Another comment about a specific location here, shifting gears a bit. So there is a nuisance flooding problem that is inland in South Chatham, north of 28. You can kind of see it on the map in industrial Commerce Park. That is an area that's surrounded by a good bit of impervious pavement. And it's not, why would it be? Because there's no rainfall associated with this model, but that's a notable, costly, and annoying spot.
Okay. We can look at any of these areas in the map viewer.
Gotcha.
In this session. Yeah. But yeah, as you noted, the rainfall precipitation stormwater component is not in this assessment.
Yeah, that is purely a rainfall related situation.
Okay.
And it's, how do I say this nicely? It's primarily because of lack of maintenance of the stormwater infrastructure on private roads. Mm. I mean, we've known about that situation for quite a while, and the town only has very limited ability, if any at all, frankly, to do much about it because of the fact they're private roads. So
that actually brings up another thing that's worth mentioning here, is that we assessed all of the potentially vulnerable coastal roads in town. We do note, whether they're private, municipally owned, state owned, and in some cases, in some towns, maybe federally owned. We acknowledge that the town has control and autonomy over the roadways that are municipally accepted, and not over the privately owned roads. And then there's this sort of in between for state owned roads where you may elect to pursue some adaptation planning for a state owned road, acknowledging that you don't really have control, but maybe a leverage point to start a discussion with MassDOT.
So I'm thinking that this is probably a really good time to move over to the map viewer and have you do your tutorial, Joe.
Yeah.
And while you're working on getting that set up, I'll just mention that this, what Joe is going to show us is, and all this information that we've been talking about has been compiled into a data viewer, which is available on the Cape Cod Commission website. It's an interactive tool. You can turn layers on and off. And we believe it'll help hone in on the road segments that you'd like us to work on. It also has it allowed public to understand which roads are vulnerable and the level of risk. And there is also a comment option, a comment tool as part of this that Joe will go over when he does this tour of the data viewer.
Are you all seeing the right screen here?
Yes. Okay. Well, we're seeing the web page for the Low Lying Road Project.
Okay, great. So when you arrive at the Commission's Low Lying Roads Project website, you will have, as you scroll down, a description of the project, and then this matrix of all the towns involved in the project. If you click on Chatham, you'll be directed to another page that has all of the Chatham specific information. As we move forward, there will be other tabs that have presentations and adaptation designs. But for now, we have the map viewer. And if you click on that, you'll be able to access all of this data that we've been talking about. So there's a little set of instructions on the left-hand side here that talk about the project and how to navigate the web viewer, the map viewer. You can hide that or bring it back as you need to with this arrow here. and you have five buttons here that are relevant to navigating. So the first one is going to show the legend. The second one is going to show all the different layers that you can turn on or off. The third one is the ability to make comments. So there are two layers here, coastal erosion comments and coastal flooding comments. If those are turned on in this layer list, you can click on whatever you want to comment on, and that activates a tool where you can click on any point in the map and give your input. There's a variety of drop-down menus to answer questions, and then a free form comment box. Those are only active if you turn on those layers. So we're interested in your input on both coastal flooding and coastal erosion as they pertain to roadways and resilience. The fourth button here allows you to select different base maps. So you might want OpenStreetMap, or I find imagery to be helpful so you can see where the wetlands are and beaches and dunes, et cetera. And finally, the last button on the right here is all of those priority road segments that were identified through this process. If you click on any of them, it will bring you to that segment. Go to Bridge Street, zoom out using the scroll button. And I think a good thing to review here is all the different layers. So these top vulnerable roads, that list of bookmarks, are these black lines that you can turn on and off. Again, coastal erosion and coastal flooding comments, you can turn on and off and be able to use them over on this button. We have the high tide flooding over time. So comparing those sea level rise projections, adjusted to mean high water, 2030, 2050, 2070. We have the inundation probability. So the comparison of the water surface elevations to the road elevation. So you can turn on any of those and click on a node, and that will get you the probability and the elevation. The criticality results are also available. And again, you can click on any node to get an assessment of all the scores that went into that score. That's backed up as you come down the list here by all of the supporting data. So we have the locations of the community and emergency services that are symbolized by those red and green dots, functional class of the road network from local to arterial and collector roads, traffic counts. You can click on those and get those estimates from the MassDOT database. Bus routes, got a couple of those here. Let's turn on a different base layer. So bus routes were one of the components. We have the business activity density layer, which was a regional data set, and the social vulnerability index for transportation access from the CDC. Those have scores also. So those were all the factors that went into the criticality assessment. In addition to those probability and criticality, then we also have the risk scores. So if you click on one of those nodes, you can get the elevation of the roadway, the criticality score, and the inundation probability for 2030 or 2050. Or 2070. So that's kind of the quick tour of the data viewer. Hopefully it gives you some good access and ways to explore the various pieces of information that went into this assessment.
And I just want to mention that Michelle put a link to the website that Joe showed you before he opened up the map viewer in the chat. So you can click on that and it'll bring you directly to the low-lying roads website.
Hey, Joe, in the view you have up right now.
Yes.
What's the difference between a white road segment and the ones that are just grayed out?
You mean the ones that have white dots versus the ones that don't?
Yeah.
So
you can't tell if they're dots at this scale, but yes. Right.
Yeah. So that's a good question. So the way that we selected roads for the assessment was we extracted the maximum footprint of potential flooding from the Massachusetts Coast Flood Risk Model. So the 0.1% 2070 extent of flooding. Anything that was within that, any road segment that was within that, we broke up into these nodes, these dots that you see on the screen and assessed. If it was high enough in elevation that it was outside of any potential future flooding, we didn't assess it. And that's what you're seeing, the difference between something that was assessed with these nodes versus something that has no data. Does that make sense?
It does, but it I'm trying to understand how it came to be then, because I'm looking at this and I see Inlet Road, that kind of circular road on the, you know, the middle left, if you will. Yeah. Inlet Road has a low point that is extremely low. Yeah, right in there. I mean, it's basically down at, you know, sea level, if you will. Yeah. But then Bridge Street on the east side of the Mitchell River, that's all up high. And I can't understand that that would ever be subject to any kind of flooding.
Yeah.
So it's like, why is the lower level of Inlet Road not white dots? And yet Bridge Street at its, what is basically its highest point, why is that white dots? I mean, it just doesn't seem to make, have any real rhyme or reason to it.
There could be, if what you're saying, Inlet Road is low, it should be in here. So sometimes there's a just a data symbolization hiccup that could be in this data viewer. We'll look into that.
Okay. I mean, yeah, because I'm just that just popped out to me right at, you know.
Yeah.
Just looking at it quickly, because I mean, the east side of Bridge Street is very high, and you know, I can't see why that would ever be an area that would potentially be prone to flooding.
Yeah. So let's see.
I'm saying the same thing that the lighthouse overlook area.
So the extent of flooding is based on the kind of large scale probability analysis. You know, those first set of maps that have nodes that are, you know, could be spaced 3 to 5 meters apart, and drawing those flood patterns based on that. This assessment takes that down to the street level a little bit more. So there may be areas, as you see here in Bridge Street, that we assessed because they were in this interpolated potential area of flooding. But when we really drill down into the water, comparing the water surface elevation to, as you said, you know, 30, almost 32 feet, NAVD 88, it's not, there's, you know, no chance of flooding. So it's a little bit in the way we do the analysis that factored into, you know, some roads may be high, they're in there because they're in an area that just kind of is a factor of the model mesh, to be honest. But doing the site specific analysis, that obviously has a 0% chance. The other thing within the road, I think, is a symbolization thing that we have to look into.
So is it possible to turn off those white dots and just keep the colored ones? I think all those white dots are misleading for people.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's just a different way of symbolizing that we can talk with the commission staff and GIS.
Okay. All right. Well, just, you know. All right.
There should be on the legend, zero is white. I think we need an outline there to differentiate, but
Joe, Ted here again. I'm kind of circling back to what we were discussing earlier, you know, kind of on the criticality, you know, approach. In some ways, I think it's good news that, you know, at least for Chatham, we don't have like major evacuation routes and downtown centers that are, you know, highly vulnerable.
Yeah.
So that's good. So most of our vulnerabilities, more or less residential areas, you know, with access to neighborhoods, et cetera. And, you know, which is obviously very important, particularly during emergency management or response. And unfortunately, I'm just not sure that this is capturing that type of issue. Again, I'm just repeating what we had mentioned earlier, that if you can't get to a whole section of the community, that's a big deal.
Right.
But we're not really highlighting that. other than showing that these roads potentially, you know, flood a lot. But the criticality component of getting to a whole aspect of the community isn't really being picked up, unless I'm missing something.
Yeah, it's not coming out in the, you know, top-down analysis, but I'll show you some examples here, Ted, that, you know, as we went through and sifted through the results, we did identify some areas that kind of fit that criteria, right? So Fox Hill Road, you know, that's a connection to this Nickerson's Neck area, low spot by the Crow Pond Landing. That's kind of a one way in, one way out situation.
Yep, exactly. An excellent example. And that whole, you know, outer area, as you showed floods, you know, unfortunately, it's mostly private, so there's limited opportunity to some extent. But that's a very good example of what we're kind of referring to.
Yeah, so I think same thing here with.
Pardon me. Yeah, and that was another one right there. I know that C-pine. One.
Yeah, so C-pine. Was another example that we you know noted that sort of one way in, one way out condition to a vulnerable neighborhood. Barn Hill Road, I think, was another example.
Barn Hill, I'm having trouble picturing where Barn Hill's.
So how was that captured in the criticality index? Because it's not a, you know, it's not a fire station or a
it's
town
not
hall or police station or whatever.
Yeah.
It's simply a residential neighborhood.
So we didn't strictly rely on risk to inform our selection of roads. And to be honest, that's why we're talking. That's why we're asking you to key in on some of these other areas and give us suggestions, because, you know, we didn't have a way of, you know, analytically accounting for these one way in, one way out situations. So we looked at risk and then made some additional recommendations.
Couldn't you simply have a one way in, one way out, yes or no? And you know,
yeah, we could
check that and you give it an extra point or whatever to factor into your thing. Could, you know, anyway, the thought that, you know, that might be a fairly simple way to capture, you know, that class, if you will, or that situation.
Yeah, it was, I think, just something that didn't go into the original planning of that approach.
Okay.
But, you know, it's, as I said, certainly something for the communities to focus in on and highlight. And like I said, we did try to identify those roads in these lists, you know, if they didn't quite fall in through the risk process.
Yeah, I mean, I assume by Barn Hill, you're talking about the area with the marsh on either side, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, right there. Yep.
Yep. So that's a large area one way. To my knowledge, there isn't any other way in.
Yeah, that's classic one way in, one way out. Right. Absolutely. Yep.
And I think this last one, Taylor's Pond Road, is another example of that. Smaller neighborhood, but still one way in, one way out. If there are others that you know you want to explore, you know, dig into the data, and we can talk about the probability and the vulnerability of any of these, and maybe that becomes a road that you select for adaptation.
Are we avoiding state roads? Because this is really a Chatham related study. So 28 is not something that we need to concern ourselves with, because that one portion of 28 up by Jackknife that seems to get cut off would, I mean, if you could just turn on volume, you know, road volume, I think, you know, that one would rise much higher in terms of disruption and cost, but it's also a state highway. So is it really something we should be concerned about here so much in Chatham with our own resources?
It's a choice, right?
Route 28 doesn't flood at Jackknife and Chatham. It floods on the Harwich side.
Well, there's a couple, then it's further down towards Ryder's Cove. There was a
There's one at Ryder's Cove at the Herring Run, and then there's Frostfish Creek.
Well, I'm thinking of those two. That road probably has the most volume of all the ones that have been identified.
Yeah, and we're working with MassDOT right now on the Frostfish Creek situation. That's been on my list for 30 years, trying to get MassDOT to address that. But you know, it up until now, it hasn't been a high priority for them. And the same thing at the low point by Ryder's Cove there. It's one of those things that, okay, Route 28 floods there, but you've got an alternative to get around that flooded area. You know, you go down Old Comers and then
back around
that way. So there is a detour around. If that area floods, you can get around it. You know, where some of those areas like Fox Hill, there is no way around. There's no alternative to that one way in, one way out.
Yep.
Yeah. Anyway. The traffic card counts are hard to see here, but you can click on a segment and look at it.
I'll just chime in for a moment on the larger question about the next phase of this project for the town of Chatham, you know, whether the town selects a town owned and controlled road or a state road. Certainly engaging MassDOT is difficult, and a longer effort is involved there. But there are other towns that prioritized segments of state highways because for them, they really rose to the top in terms of importance for the community and connectivity. So I think this discussion is really helpful. This is our purpose, is to present the analysis based on, as Joe indicated, the regional data sets that we have available to us together with the MCFRM, and then get your feedback from that. And you know your roads, you know the neighborhoods. Other considerations might be in trying to pick roads that become the focus of the next phase of this work are we talking about year-round communities that are cut off, or are they, seasonal communities, neighborhoods? There can be a whole number of factors that play into the town's decision-making process on which two roads to nominate for our work going forward for this grant. And then, of course, we hope that the analysis is, that continues to be useful for the community in prioritizing additional roads that you may look at in the future.
And I'll jump in here too, as we're looking at the time, and I don't want to cut anyone off in terms of discussion, because this has been great. But I also want to be respectful of your time, and it is getting late. And so I was thinking I would move on to the next slide, but waiting to see if there was any pressing comments or questions that we should take before we move on to the next slide.
Ted, just in this slide kind of, is a good example. We already just touched on it, just to again repeat it. And I'm kind of following up on your comment, Heather, that I think you're right. Like the 28 here at near Ryder's Cove, we're familiar with it. It's a state highway. It is, I think, an important and a critical priority at some level. But maybe not as part of this study. We kind of just we recognize it, and this study has identified it as such. But when we pick our priorities, we kind of put that one in our hip pocket and deal with the state independently and look at more those roads or sections that are more under our control, like, say, for instance, the Crow's Pond, because we know it is the critical access to that whole outer community, if you will. So I think we can or should, you know, keep our priorities more at the ones that are more, you know, our control level. I can fully, you know, respect that other communities, you know, may not do it that way because the state road may be the highest thing that needs to be addressed and addressed quickly. I'm not quite sure we're there. I may be missing one, but I think we're going to focus more on those roads that are under our, you know, control to access, you know, sections of the community.
Yeah. And that makes sense. Yeah. For Chatham.
Are you going to give us a schedule as to how when we have to make these kinds of decisions or you know, what the time frame and steps are so that?
Yeah, I was going to go over next steps, although actually, Heather, if you could put back up that the presentation, I'll show the next steps. It doesn't provide a timeline for when we need or would like to have comments, but I would say, you know, in the next couple weeks, maybe month, it'd be great to get some feedback on these. We, will be going into the field. So so initially what will happen, well, we'll have the town staff will be selecting two segments. And so, putting comments into that map viewer, any of you or anyone who's listening, watching this and that did not attend tonight, I encourage you to go to that map viewer and add comments so that we have a better understanding of some of the roads that maybe, you know, that you were bringing up tonight that weren't shown on the map viewer. And then in the summertime, we'll conduct the site visits for these segments, for this roadways and look at feasibility analysis. And so that's kind of far off, but the sooner we get the selected roads, the sooner we can make the schedule and get out into the field to do these site visits. So I think anywhere from, let's say a month, within a month's time frame, that we to get those comments and to get feedback would be about what we need, the about a good time frame, but like a month away. So what are we, April? Oh, almost June. Yeah, so a couple weeks. By the end of June, it'd be really helpful to have those, that input so that the town can select two road segments. And then the next part would be developing three solutions and the costs that go along with it. And then we'll come back to you with a second workshop in the spring of 2024 to present those solutions. In the meantime, as Joe was pointing out on the website, there are materials available and more will be added to the Chatham Low-Lying Roads website. The overview tab is currently there and as is the map viewer. And as we add information, you'll see more tabs along this row. The next one will be a materials tab, and that will have this workshop recording as well as the slide deck that anyone can look at and review. And any other material that would be available will populate this website so that it can be your resource for information as it's developed. And then we will, I think that's just a screenshot of the map viewer. So yeah, that's about it for tonight. That wraps up what we planned on presenting. And I really appreciate your time and all of your thoughtful comments. And we'll be back in touch. And Heather, did you have any closing comments that you wanted to make?
No. I guess if there were any last questions, burning questions, we could field those, but otherwise I think we appreciate everyone's participation.
Great. Yeah, thank you guys. Great presentation.
Thank you.
That was when you guys really went into, or Joe, when you went into that map viewer, there's a lot of info there.
Yes.
I I don't mean to sound defeatist. I don't expect you're going to see hundreds and hundreds of comments being added.
Yeah.
No.
Even though there are opportunities, I'm just not quite sure you're going to get what potentially could be gotten out of that. But there is definitely a lot of information that went into that. So that's impressive.
Yeah, I mean, that's okay too. I mean, we think of it as a resource for the town to use in the future.
Understood.
Is that commenting tool going to be available even after the decisions are made about low-lying sections going forward?
Yes, I mean, the viewers will remain, you know, into the foreseeable future as a resource for the community. You can add comments. I think, you know, Tara's comment about making your comments in the next couple of weeks so that town staff can give us feedback within a month or so, I think is appropriate, because we need to be able to get out in the field and do some assessments of, you know, the roads that the town would like us to look at.
Just on that, Heather, real quick, or whomever, and I'm trying to think of, you know, maybe just Morris Island Road, just as an example. We recognize it is a, you know, difficult access, flood potential. But then if we were to choose it, for instance, and then you look at the environmental impacts of how to deal with it, that could be, you know, quote, insurmountable potentially. And again, I'm not saying that one is there a, you know, plan B? Well, we throw that one out, even though it was a high priority. Now we have to pick another one.
We could talk through some of those things before we get too deep into it, Ted.
Yeah, I mean, I think that practically speaking, if Ted, you and Bob and other town staff that you would like to engage in this discussion could identify 4 or 5 road segments that are priorities, and then we could go out and look at those and have some more discussion with you about, you know, the viability of you know, spending time looking at design alternatives for those particular roads.
Okay, I think that's a good idea. I think having a, you know, a basket full of more options is better. And once we get there, and with your own insight and going, well, these are the issues you have to wrestle with, and then we change our mind or whatever. So I think that's a good idea.
Mm-hmm. Great.
Sounds good.
All right. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a good night.